We are in Belgium at ICP Studios because we are in the process of recording our third full-length album.
Walking into the studio is just a whole nother level. Like, Pharrell's been here and we are not worthy.
And the first thing you kind of see when you come through the door is loads of gold records.
They got a gym, they got a swimming pool, there's a garden with two footballs, four different studio rooms. You got A, B, C, and I can't remember the last one.
We've never been to a studio where there's just been like kind of like loads of separate rooms where we can kind of individually record or write stuff and work on like more than one thing at one time. And we've also got the luxury of having, like, for example, the swimming pool and like the TV area and like just like the kitchen stuff. Like, we've got somewhere we can kind of do all our own things that isn't, so we're not just constantly listening and doing music.
The creative process is better when you can kind of get away from it for a couple of hours if you need to.
Yeah, it's important to have an area to decompress after a day in the studio. Not having that chill space, like, for example, we didn't on album one.
Well, album one, we literally recorded in a fridge up north somewhere, which was horrible. It was tiny, it was cold.
It really does do wonders for the overall vibe and then consequently our happiness in the actual studio. Literally, they have more or less every bit of equipment you could possibly imagine. It's been one of my hobbies really, just going through all the guitars in the, or not even all the guitars, but a good chunk of the guitars in the back room.
Shit ton of keyboards, you got Moogs, you got, that's the only name of a one that I know. Rhodes, that's one, isn't it, right?
You think, there's going to be loads of restrictions on this and we're not going to be able to touch or play any of this, but their attitude towards it is just, it's built to be played. Like, all these things are made to be used and there's kind of just like a mutual assumed respect with it, and you're kind of just allowed to dip into whatever you want because they just understand that you're going to be careful with it, which is just awesome.
There's no one kind of like looking over your shoulder kind of like, yo, what are you doing with that? That's really expensive. Like, we've literally just got access to like everything.
Honestly, a little bit intimidated really. Like, it's probably the nicest studio we've ever been in.
Correct place to be making the album that we're making.
Down for 4 bars.
60 times zoom.
Stop telling people. 60?
He's like Darth Vader when he's in his like fridge and they're like putting all the bits on him. And like, this thing is sexy bad.
Yeah!
Other boys don't know how to act.
Yeah!
So for this album, we are recording with Jason Perry.
He has worked with the likes of McFly and Don Broco. And not someone that we necessarily thought that we would get the opportunity to work with.
He is very highly regarded, Grammy award-winning producer, has a massive plethora of artists that he's worked with, and just mad. He's mad.
Dan, go get him a beer!
Fucking hell,
man,
I'm trying to make a record, Dan, for your band! Selfish prick! Is there a free ball? Out of head, Sandbox! Get out of the fucking way, you clown! Idiot! You're a fucking idiot! Idiot! You're a fucking idiot!
That's fucking ace!
That's what he says whenever he hears a bit of a song where he just gets into it. It's like, oh, boys, that's fucking ace!
My name is Jason, and I'm here to help Trashboat make a record. Sometimes I don't know. Sometimes I hinder. I've seen the name on a poster. So I was aware of the music through seeing their name on a poster. And then I listened to one song and I thought, yeah, that's all right, but there's somewhere to go with this.
I think the day after he confirmed we got on our first Zoom call together, and we already made one of our song choruses 10 times better, and it's on the album.
He would listen to our songs and he wouldn't pull any punches. He'd just be like, yeah, this verse, stock, rubbish, don't like it. Lyrics here, rubbish. Melody here, rubbish. This needs to change. And he'd be honest where he needed to be.
Just thought there was something in there which we could bring out, which was not kind of stock rock. There's a lot of bands that sound the same. Getting to know them, getting to know Oakley and his production and all his ideas as well.
Yeah! Redo me. From the top.
That sounded wicked!
So day one, Jason delivered a speech in the main control room, just G'ing everybody up, got everyone excited, and also probably put any initial nerves at ease.
I come across as I don't know what I'm doing, and hopefully that is the case. But that is because I do know what I'm doing, and I know at the end of it we'll have an amazing record. But what I don't ever want is anyone to stress about it, because stressing about it and worrying about time and worrying about this and getting that done and getting that done doesn't help it. The music doesn't know. Do you know what I mean? So we've just got to kind of trust the process, trust me, trust in each other, and trust that it will get done. So some days we'll feel like we've cracked it, we've got loads done. Other days we'll feel like we've got nothing done. But there's always stuff being done.
It's like, okay, we're going to do like a couple hours drums here, whatever, you're bored of that, fine. Let's go do a couple of hours of vocals now. Or like, okay, you're sick of that. Why don't you guys go in the other room while we're doing this and track some of the guitars?
Get it all done. And what I don't ever do is, we need drums now, and we do 2 days of bass, and we're doing 3 days of guitar. We don't work like that. We just do bits and bobs all the time. It's not really about impressing your peer group. It's about touching the hearts of the listener. We've talked about this loads, and we've started to get it with these songs, so let's keep that process going. So try and lose your mindset of where you are level-wise, Kerrang-wise, and peer group-wise. Let's start thinking in terms of Adele and Duran Duran and Madness and Metallica and Muse. And big bands, right? Big bands who know, who understand space and understand confidence. That's it. It's gonna be easy. Yeah.
It felt like after he gave that speech, it felt like we were just gonna go and do the album there and then, just like bang.
What are you doing there, Dan?
Conductors. Conducting. Putting like that and then. There it goes, join the guitar and the amp.
So you're playing conductors at the minute. Why don't you play screensavers? Hi. Oh, this is a big one. Is he gonna make it? Oh, he's hit the post. Oh.
Spending so much time with the same people in what is effectively a steel box for however long like a tour is.
Your only option is to have the strongest bond ever and be the best buddies or be mortal enemies, really. You spend that much time with each other that there's no middle ground. Fortunately, we're all really good mates, so it sort of stood the test of time.
60 times.
And some woes, and then you've got...
I can see it zooming.
If you're having a bad day, like we're all still sat in that same van going to like the next show or whatever, and we kind of see each other's highs and lows and are like very much there for each other throughout all of that. So I guess like the bond that we have is kind of amazing because we kind of like have kind of been through everything together.
Me and Oakley started playing music together when we were like 11 years old. Met Ryan when we were like, what, 14, I suppose, and then James when we were like 15. And we've been playing music together ever since then. Toby joined us slightly later when we were like 19, 20. That's when we started this band.
Being able to go on tour and travel the world with five of your best friends most of the year, just having a laugh, sitting in a van, cracking jokes, being idiots, being mean.
The more time we've spent in the band, the more we've sort of understood how far we can push each other, what people's limits are, when to leave it out.
It may not be true with all bands, it might just be a trash boat thing, but we're just fucking nasty to each other, like really horrible. Just like long drive in the van, and you never know if it's going to be your day, right? You're the one getting picked on today.
Yeah, so I'm Dan and I really like drinking beer. Oh, hi, I'm Dan. Look at me, I've got beer.
But at the core of it all is a project that you all are completely in love with and that is working. And I love doing it. I love doing it with them. And I wouldn't have it any other way.
Take the song.
I've got my first real six string, bought it at the five and dime.
I even show my fingers, man. Was the summer of 69. Me and the guys from the school had a band and we tried real hard.
Jimmy quit. Should've known we'd never get far.
Yeah, I think for every band, album three pressures on to really step it up to the next level. Everyone can put out a good first record and, you know, get some fans. Second record, it's like, okay, whatever, you know, you do another one of the same things, which I kind of feel like we did. We were like, first record went well, second record was like, okay, here's that again, but a bit heavier.
Lots of discussions, the band being like, maybe we need like a thing or like a sound to kind of like latch onto more than we have before, rather than these kind of like, this weird kind of like pop punk, slightly heavy crossover.
More punk than pop punk, so what are we gonna do with that? Maybe we can go like down the like Rise Against route or the Alexis on Fire route.
So we all grew up listening to X, and then when we write music, we're like, God, I wanna write music like X so that people who listen to X will like me and I can have the same experiences and blah, blah, blah. And it's all this rubbish that you just end up overthinking in your mind when writing instead of just letting it flow. And Jason helps us to kind of just smash any preconception of what we think we wanted to sound like.
I think he kind of looks at it from like less of like a music standpoint and kind of like a what makes you feel a certain way, or kind of like music that like gives you some sort of emotion or a vibe, or like music that reminds you of a place or a time. And I think he's kind of looking at music in that sort of manner rather than kind of being like, oh, this is the correct thing to do.
The overthinking of writing songs really jeopardizes the outcome. And the fuck it mentality Jason Perry always pushes has really helped us.
It kind of threw that idea of like, yo, we have to commit to this thing or this sound or this image. Like, we just kind of started writing really like raw songs with him.
We'll just throw riffs back and forth and throw melodies back and forth. And if something lands, we work on it. And if we like the sound of something, we work on it. And it can end up, and it has ended up on this record, where you can have five or six songs that sound like different bands.
God save our gracious Queen, and let's not have us stay. God save the Queen. Oh, fair enough, he got me.
So if you run straight up.
That's a good one, that's a good rally one. Fantastic, fucking hell.
Oh yeah.
This is going good.
This is going viral. I'm so sweaty.
Oh my God, this is fucking amazing.
Jason has made us listen to a lot more music that we wouldn't tend to listen to in the past. There's a lot of 90s music in there. It'll be like 1 a.m. and I'll get a text off and being like, listen to this band. And he sent me a band the other night called Soul Wax. And I listened to the entire album in bed and I'm like, this is sick.
So mad, is it? No, he's the best.
Somebody mentions the band or anything, I'll stop whatever we're doing
and put a reference on Spotify. Because to me, like listening to 30 seconds of something you didn't expect is up there with a morning's work, really.
He'll always, without fail, be able to pull out a really strange niche reference. And it will just be like, this would work in this part. And he always gets it spot on. And he always finds it in about 3 seconds.
Really hard to make a record at our age if we like anything. It's easy when you're 15. It's all about Green Day and feels like shit. You make a Green Day record. But when you're our age, you like everything, and we all appreciate everything, and we're all democracy, and everything's good. But can we be better than good?
Yes. I really like the way that Jason likes to record an album. I think it's much more freeing, it's much more natural. You get a much better vibe from the way he likes to do things, which is, you know, set up to do drums and set up to do vocals, you just do each for like maybe a couple of hours.
Wrong lyric and I fucked up,
because
yeah.
We tracked shells and cymbals separately, which was difficult. Was hard, which did take longer, but it does sound amazing, and Jason was right, as much as I hated doing it.
And our last album was, we already had it all done, and then it was just a case of tracking it and mixing it, whereas this is very much a creative process all in, where we're writing as we go.
I don't know.
I think we get away from that rhythm and just go da da.
Hang on.
Can you go, drugs work until they don't, and we'll do a drugs work.
And we're recording as we go, and you know, we can go back and do another chorus vocally because I felt like I wrote something better.
It could be a pre, it could be just drums. Drugs work.
Yeah.
Until they don't.
We could change the into the chorus.
Stuff has changed a lot in the studio from what we expected it to sound like as well. And although that's challenging, I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing at all. I've really enjoyed the creative process of that.
I've been sat tracking with Ryan a lot of the time, so just sort of sitting there with my stepbrother, and you could zone out and just imagine you're in a bedroom or something. There's no pressure.
Know how to record a bit, like, why don't you go and make the use of like your own time here rather than just kind of waiting for me to come and do the same thing with you. And like, we kind of will go off, work on our stuff while Jason's doing stuff, and then we'll kind of all come together, put some stuff together. And
that's wicked.
We'll open a song on the Monday and be like, ooh, maybe we should put a synth in.
Start lower.
That's amazing. We're getting more Beatles than that.
Sitting down like applause from a roaring crowd. I can drown all I can ever be.
We'll just layer up. Does it sound good? Yep, let's put it in. Does it sound bad? Okay, let's delete it. And I feel like it's a really really new way for us to work.
There is an unfortunate reality in that, you know, you can have as much heart and soul and passion and drive as you want, but in order to exist as an adult, you need to be able to support yourself financially.
We've achieved more than we ever would have dreamed we have as this band, like from the beginning, like up to this point anyway. But it does kind of get to the point where it's like, yo, we've got like bills to pay, we've got things we want to do, like our lives are kind of changing and moving forward. And
whilst it would be quite hurtful for it to come out and everyone be like, oh, this is shit, for us, we've all decided that this is a massive step up for the band, and we're all very pleased with all of these songs and think they're much, much better than anything we've done in the past.
It would be great if kind of like people appreciated like what we put into it and kind of like got something from the music. And obviously as well as that, it'd be nice to be like being able to headline some bigger venues and kind of like get some better festival slots and all those kind of things. And
more of the same, you know, but just more, really, more shows, hopefully bigger shows, hopefully bigger festivals, just more, we just want more.
As long as I can stand in front of a group of people and feel a truth and a vulnerability in the sharing of the live performance, then I'm happy. That's success in my mind. I just want to stand in front of however many people, look into their eyes, sing the songs that I've written or that we've written, and have them feel exactly what I'm feeling and share it to the absolute maximum. And that's my favorite part of being in a band, and that to me is success.
Yeah, this album could do terribly. It could sell no units. People could hate it. But as long as I'm proud of the music that I've written, I'd always be happy knowing that I put out the best album I possibly could at that time in my life.
Well done, Trashboat. I hope this album is successful, and I hope you all get swimming pools. Can I have one as well?
Stop.